Good evening. I would like to call this meeting to order of the Elk Grove Unified School District at 5:10 PM. The board will now meet in closed session to address items 1 through 3. Mr. May, are we good? Okay. All right. Good evening. And welcome to the Elk Grove Unified School District's board meeting. The Board of Education has resumed in full-person board meetings unless remote attendance is permitted pursuant to California Brown Act. Live streaming of full in-person board meetings will be available to the public via the Zoom platform. Today's meeting is being video recorded and will be available on the district's YouTube channel. The board met in closed session and no action was taken. Public comment information. During regular board meetings, the public may make public comments on items on the agenda or items not on the agenda. Requests to make public comment will be accepted for an item up until the board president introduces the item. Generally, members of the public will be given 3 minutes to address the board. If there are 15 or more comments on a specific item, the board will reduce individual comment time to 2 minutes each. If there are 30 or more comments on a specific item, the board will reduce individual comments to 1 minute each. Individuals may not defer their time to another individual speaker to increase their total speaking time. Please be mindful that district students may be watching. You are encouraged to address the board and the public in a respectful manner, such that all those observing, from children to adults, are made to feel welcome, safe, and valued. The board shall not permit any disturbance or willful interruption of the board meetings. Persistent disruption by an individual or group shall be grounds for the privilege of the president to provide a warning and then to terminate the individual's privilege of addressing the board. And now I would like to read our land acknowledgement. We acknowledge that the Elk Grove Unified School District administrative facilities and schools occupy the unceded territory of the Miwok, the original people of the skies, land, and waters where we work and learn. The Miwok have cared for these lands since time immemorial. They continue to teach their traditional knowledge that comes from and responds to the needs of the land and people who share it. May our daily lives and work teaching, learning, leadership, and community engagement support the evolving vision of the Miwok for their community and these lands. May we strive to acknowledge the past for the betterment of our future generations. May we look to our tribal partners, the Wilton Rancheria, the descendants of the original people of this land, to assist with the successful education of our community. And now, I would like to invite the Coda family to come on up with their principal, Julie Hughes. Come on up. And I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Albiani, who's going to say a few words.
Hi. Arnold Adriani Elementary School is honored to recognize Mr. John Toda and Ms. Allison Sonoda and their daughters Emily, who is in sixth grade, and Kayla in fourth grade, as our educational partners. Both Emily and Kayla have attended Adriani since transitional kindergarten and are excellent students. Allison has been an active Adriana PTA member since 2018 and has served on the board for the last 5 years. Her hobbies include arts, crafts, and shopping. John has been an Adriana PTA member since 2018 and recently took on the role of PTA president. His hobbies include traveling and sports, 49ers, Kings, and Giants. The family has assisted with many successful PTA events over the years, including Adriani's Trunk or Treats, Donuts with Grownups, Spring Dances, Spaghetti Feed, Spring Festivals, the annual Scholastic Book Fair, and even a grown-up-only event for parents, to name just a few. Even Grandma, Jeanette Sonoda, whom the staff affectionately calls Grandma Toda, has kept the staff happy with baked goods over the past 8 years. Her banana muffins are a sight favorite. She also makes year-end memory bags for the TK classes annually. John and Allison share that they feel lucky to have the opportunity to be involved with the school in so many ways. The Adriani staff and administration feel that we are the lucky ones. It is a privilege to have the Toda family's partnership on campus. Their commitment to the Arnold Adriani community makes a big impact for our students and their family. We applaud you. Go ahead and lead the flag. Okay.
Well, we have folks who have braved the weather and joined us tonight for our student regional report for our Pleasant Grove region. We're going to have Pleasant Grove High School, Albiani Middle School, Arnold Adriani Elementary, Edna Beatty Elementary, Cosumnes River Elementary, Dillard Elementary, Robert McGarvey Elementary, Pleasant Grove Elementary, and Sunrise Elementary, all represented tonight. So I will go ahead and turn it over to the student representatives.
Oh, thank you. Good evening, board. My name is Atoba Defna, and I'm a senior at Pleasant Grove High School, and I also serve as BSU's president.
My name is Ariana Barber, and I'm in eighth grade at Catherine Albiani Middle School, and I'm honored to serve as Albiani's ASB president. We are honored to be here tonight to highlight how much we love our region.
We are here to present both our schools as well as our elementary schools, including Arnold Adriani, Edna Beatty, Cosumnes River, C.W. Dillard, Robert J. McGarvey, Pleasant Grove, Sierra Enterprise, and also Sunrise Elementary Schools.
Throughout the presentation, you will see photos on the screen displaying all of our schools. We represent the biggest region in the district in size. With this large size, over 200 square miles, we remain extremely close.
Each of our schools work to make sure all our students are supported. Staff at our schools work to articulate across the grade levels to ensure students are prepared for the next stage of education and life.
Not only do we have the largest region in the district, but we also have the biggest hearts.
Throughout the region, each school may have their own mascots and slogans, but we all focus on friendship and kindness.
One example of this is our region uniting to recognize and honor Ruby Bridges with our annual Ruby Bridges Walk to School Day. Each student in our region took part and emphasized the value of tolerance, respect, and appreciation of all differences.
Schools in our region incorporate a program called Advancement via Individual Determination, otherwise known as AVID, to help our students prepare for college, career, and life-ready graduates. Impressively, over 75% of the class of 2023 graduates completed their A through G requirements. This is outstanding.
We have a number of ways for our families to participate in activities with each other. From fun runs to harvest festivals and open houses, we love having our families on campus with us and sharing in the educational experience.
In our schools, we make sure to find ways to integrate all our students into our programs and opportunities. We love to find ways for students to shine and have our families connected to our schools.
Our visual and performing arts, or VAPA, is an area where we shine as students have the opportunity to show their creativity. To highlight some of our VAPA programs, Sunrise Elementary School has a video of their musical, Beauty and the Beast. Students wanted to be here to perform, but tonight is the opening night of their performance. If you'd like to go watch, they will be performing Wednesday and Thursday night this week.
No one says no to that song. Dismissed, rejected, publicly humiliated. Why, more like a man. Oh, I agree.
Gosh, it did start me to see that on, looking so down in the dumps. Every fat girl loved to be best on, even when taking your lumps. There's no man in town as it's mine. You're really won't change time. No one's like that best on, no one's quick at gas, no one's next as incredibly thick as gas. You can ask any Tom doctors, and they'll tell you to see you for perfectly on. Nobody likes a guest song.
To display our love and affection that we have for each other in our region, today we have a gift for you guys. As another example of our students' gifts, today we have Edna Beatty's Elementary School's K-pop club here tonight to perform. Please welcome the Edna Beatty K-pop club.
Sorry. Ready?
So lovely.
Parents, you can come closer. Bring those cameras up.
Thank you.
Excellent job. Good job. Great job, everybody. Wow.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here tonight. We love our region.
I do want to recognize that we do have some of our principals here, Tegan Keplinger, Christopher Rostenfels, Julie Hughes, Will Jones, Michael Blomquist, Sandy Weiss, Carrie Mitchell, Deidre Wood, and Martin Hawk. Thank you everybody for coming out in this weather. Okay. All right, next on the agenda, we have Arts Education Month. Ms. Jennifer Wilbanks, if you'd like to come present.
Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, Superintendent Hoffman. I'm not sure I can follow that act. And I think it's extremely fitting for what I'm here to talk about tonight. The Board of Education is requested to approve and adopt resolution number 47 designating March 2024 as Arts Education Month. This resolution celebrates and acknowledges the importance of arts education and the many experiences and opportunities in which our students from the Elk Grove Unified School District participate throughout the year, as evidence of what you saw tonight. And I know you see on a regular basis with these presentations. The month of March has been designated Arts Education Month by the state of California. The role of arts education, which includes dance, media arts, music, theater, and visual arts, is a vital part of basic education, providing a balanced education for all students. We share the vision of ensuring that students have access to high quality arts education that is culturally relevant and inclusive in all forms as part of a comprehensive education that sparks curiosity, imagination, creativity, and joy. We celebrate many things this year, and one of which is that we've had over 4,800 staff members in EGUSD who have participated in arts education professional development. We continue to celebrate the ongoing efforts to expand our arts in our elementary schools and the many festivals that we do throughout the school year around music and art and other of the arts facets. This resolution reflects our belief that arts education is not merely an extracurricular pursuit, but an integral component of comprehensive education, enhancing the intellectual, emotional, and social development of individuals. Through our collective endorsement of Arts Education Month, we signal our commitment to fostering a culture that values and champions the arts as a fundamental element of a well-rounded education. This will only continue to grow as we celebrate the inaugural year of Proposition 28. I respectfully ask that the board adopt Resolution 47, recognizing March as Arts Education Month. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Lavasser, do we have any public comments via Zoom on this item?
Okay, there we go. The mic is on. Madam President, there are no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, are there any blue cards on this item?
We have no blue cards on this item.
I would then like to call for a motion to approve resolution number 47, designating March 2024 as Arts Education Month.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved by Ms. Albiani and seconded by Mr. Yang. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion carries. I just wanted to say I really appreciate that this weekend I was able to see Franklin High School had their fusion performance, and they brought together guest performers from Monterey Trail, Florin Valley, and PG. So I love to be able to celebrate the arts. Thank you. Okay. Ann Regali is going to present on Disability Awareness Month.
Good evening, Chairperson Jamerson, members of the board, Superintendent Hoffman, Ms. Avalos, who's not here. Thank you. I'm honored this evening to request the approval and adoption of Resolution Number 56, recognizing March 2024 as Disability Awareness Month in the Elk Grove Unified School District. But first, I would like to introduce Mary Lane Jill, who will be providing ASL interpretation. Since 2011, Ms. Lane Jill has been supporting our DHH programs at Irene B. West, Edward Harris, and Monterey Trail High School. The month of March has been designated nationally as Disability Awareness Month. The Americans with Disabilities Act prohibits discrimination against individuals with disabilities in all areas of public life, including jobs, schools, transportation, and all public and private places that are open to the general public, and assures that people with disabilities have the same civil rights protections and opportunities as everyone else. The Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, IDEA as we know it, requires all public schools to address the needs of pupils with disabilities and develop individualized education programs which provide a free and appropriate public education, reflecting the specific needs of each student. Despite the affirmative rights and recognition of students with disabilities within federal and state laws, students with disabilities face academic and social emotional challenges. The district continues to strive to increase awareness of the needs of students with disabilities and to partner with families and the community as a whole to ensure that students with disabilities have access to an equitable and appropriate education. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you very much. Ms. Levasseur, are there any public comments via Zoom?
Madam President, there's no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, are there any blue cards on this item?
We have no blue cards on this item.
I would like to call for a motion to approve resolution number 56, designating the month of March as Disability Awareness Month.
I'd like to move.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Yang and seconded by Mr. Vargas. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Can I make a comment?
Hold on. Opposed? Motion carries. Mr. Yang?
Yeah, I just want to give my thanks to all the parents, teachers, staff that provide assistance and help to those students who are disabled. I come from a family with family member of with disability, and I know how hard it is on a daily basis. And I just want to give my thanks to all of the ones who help our students with disability. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to call on Katie Thomas for National School Social Work Week.
Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, and Superintendent Hoffman.
Hi, I'm so glad.
The Board of Education is requested to adopt resolution number 55, recognizing March 3rd through 9th, 2024 as National School Social Work Week. National School Social Work Week is March 3rd through 9th, as I just stated. The theme for National School Social Work Week is Pearls of Wisdom. School social workers are trained mental health professionals and are especially skilled in identifying and providing services to students who face serious challenges to school success, including poverty, disability, discrimination, abuse, addiction, bullying, loss of a loved one, and other barriers to learning. This recognition highlights their role in helping students' academic, social and emotional challenges through the provision of services related to a student's social, emotional, and life adjustments to school and society. School social workers are the link between home, school, and community, providing direct and indirect services to students, families, and school personnel. This recognition highlights the school board's and district's support of our valued school social workers.
Thank you. Ms. Levasseur, do we have any public comments via Zoom for this item?
Madam President, we have no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, do we have any blue cards for this item?
There are no blue cards for this item.
I would then like to call for a motion to approve resolution number 55, recognizing March 3rd through 9th, 2024, is National School Social Work Week.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Vargas and seconded by Ms. Albiani. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much. We appreciate your service. And Katie, don't go. We have for Social Emotional Learning Day.
Good evening once again. The Board of Education is requested to approve and adopt resolution number 54, recognizing the second Friday in March as Social Emotional Learning Day. The second Friday in March has been recognized internationally as Social Emotional Learning Day, and this day provides an excellent occasion for Elk Grove Unified School District to demonstrate its support for integrating evidence-based SEL in our schools, organizations, and community. Although we promote an integration of SEL into every day in Elk Grove Unified, the recognition of International SEL Day is a wonderful opportunity to educate the public about SEL and its impact on our students' well-being. SEL is the process through which children and adults acquire and effectively apply the knowledge, attitudes, skills, and skills necessary to understand and manage our emotions, set and achieve positive goals, feel and show empathy for others, establish and maintain positive relationships, and make responsible decisions. SEL improves academic outcomes, builds a positive school climate, promotes positive mental health, and provides children with the necessary skills to excel in today's workforce. Additionally, SEL can help address various forms of inequity and empower our young people and our adults to co-create thriving schools and contribute to safe, healthy, and just communities. Our schools continue to develop their plan for implementing explicit instruction in the 5 core competencies of self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, and responsible decision-making, and to integrate these practice opportunities for the skills into content area instruction. This year, SEL Day is March 8th, and the theme is Today's Students, Tomorrow's Leaders. In alignment with this theme, should the board choose to adopt this resolution, we will continue to promote SEL as a necessary component of ensuring that EGUS students graduate college, career, and life ready.
Okay. Ms. Lavaster, do we have any public comments via Zoom for this item?
Madam President, we have no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, do we have any blue cards for this item?
We have no blue cards for this item.
I would like to call for a motion to approve resolution number 54, recognizing the second Friday in March as Social Emotional Learning Day.
So move.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Yang and seconded by Mr. Vargas. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now we have Ms. Donnell Black for Women's History Month.
Good evening, Madam President Jamerson, Ms. Siegel, members of the board, and Superintendent Hoffman. I come to you to request that the Board of Education adopt resolution number 51, designating March 2024 as Women's History Month. As part of the Board of Education's legacy of advocacy for equity and the value of diversity within our school district, members of the board have an opportunity to recognize the month of March as Women's History Month. Per Senate Bill 48 and AR 6143, throughout the year, elementary and secondary teachers use pieces of literature where women assume traditional and non-traditional professional roles. In their classroom instruction, teachers also use novels written by female authors. In the areas of mathematics and science, information is shared throughout the year about famous female mathematicians and scientists. Staff members at school sites are careful to provide information about women in all roles in our society, drawing students' attention to the noted as well as the underrepresented contributions that women have provided historically and in modern times. By designating one month with a focus on women's history, the Board of Education has the opportunity to communicate the value of such instruction. In support of Women's History Month, the Curriculum and Professional Learning Department will facilitate a virtual workshop on March 5th, 2024, open to all in our community, all in our district. We currently have about 284 registered for that. The topic is Uncovering America, Women in Art. That will provide an opportunity for participants to explore the art in the women's movement and how art has been used as a form of protest. This workshop supports participants in recognizing, valuing, and promoting diversity, as well as a direct connection to Arts Education Month. I request that you adopt resolution number 51, designating March 2024 as Women's History Month.
Thank you. Ms. Lavaster, do we have any public comments via Zoom for this item?
Madam President, we have no public comments via Zoom for this.
Mr. Vargas, do we have any blue cards for this item?
We have no blue cards for this item.
I would then like to call for a motion to approve resolution number 51, designating March 2024 as Women's History Month.
So move.
Second.
It's been moved by Ms. Albiani and seconded by Mr. Yang. All those in favor, please say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Requests for student expulsions. Do we have anyone who wishes to address the board in closed session regarding a student expulsion recommendation? Okay, I would like to call for a motion to approve the recommendations for student expulsion.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Vargas and seconded by Mr. Yang. All those in favor of approving the recommendations for student expulsion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Public comment for items not on the agenda. Ms. Levasseur, do we have any public comments via Zoom for items not on the agenda?
Madam President, we have no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, do we have any blue cards for items not on the agenda?
We have no blue cards for this item.
All right.
Can I make a comment?
I don't believe.
I was going to say,
does it involve you having a blue card?
I was going to say, since I've been here, this is the first time.
Yeah. Okay, next item is the consent agenda. Ms. Levasseur, do we have any public comments via Zoom for this item?
Madam President, we have no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, do we have any blue cards for this item?
We have no blue cards for this item.
I would like to call for a motion to approve items 1 through 31 on the consent agenda.
Move.
Seconded.
It's been moved by Mr. Yang and seconded by Ms. Albiani. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Bargaining units. Do we have any bargaining units who wish to address the board this evening? No? Okay. All right. And then we are on to reports and public reports and discussion items. We have the public opinion survey results. Ms. Coates.
All right. Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, Superintendent Hoffman, staff, and the public. Thank you for joining us tonight. Excited to be here to talk through our bond feasibility study. I do have two guests that are joining us. We've got Dr. Timothy McLarney with True North Research, who I'm going to bring up. And then we do have Lori Ranieri here with Government Financial Services, a well-known face, and here as an aside. So I'm actually going to hand it over to Tim. I'm going to pull up the presentation and let you go.
All right. Thank you, Kristen. Good evening, Madam President, members of the board. I am Dr. Tim McLarney, president of True North Research. We are a firm that over the last two decades has specialized in working with school districts and other types of public agencies around the state in using surveys to help them develop a statistically reliable understanding of the communities and the customers that they serve. Today, my business partner and I have worked on over 1,300 research studies for public agencies, and about half of the research that we're doing these days is what we call revenue measure feasibility studies, similar to the type of study we're going to be talking about here tonight, where the goal is to understand if it's feasible to move forward with some type of revenue measure like a bond, and if it is feasible, to understand how much you go about structuring that measure in a way that it's consistent with the type of measure that your community is interested in supporting. Happy to say we've helped our clients have a lot of success over the years. We've helped raise about $35 billion in voter-approved measures around the state. And if you go back 10 years, our overall success rate is 95%, meaning when our research suggests that you can move forward and be successful, and we make recommendations to do so, 95% of the time that those measures have ultimately been successful. I mentioned this background because as I go through tonight's presentation, perhaps in response to some of the questions you might get from the board, I may make reference to how the results we're seeing here compared to how we might see what we might see in other districts. And I wanted you to have a sense from the experience base from which I'd be speaking. I was also privileged to work with the district on the polling related to your last general obligation bond, which was successful in 2016. And finally, as I go through this presentation, I welcome questions from the board as I go or at the end, whichever is your preference. Okay. So before we discuss the actual survey results, helpful to take a moment to review the purpose of the study or why we go about doing this research, as well as the methodology. In terms of the purpose of these studies being a revenue measure feasibility study, I see it really addressing the three bullets you see here. That first overarching question is the most basic, meaning, is it feasible? If you as a board were to choose to place a measure on the November 2024 ballot, does it have a reasonable chance of success? Answer to that question isn't always yes. Sometimes we do this work, and no matter how we stare at the data, we really don't see a clear path to get you from where you are today to where you need to be viable on election day. And if that's the case, I'll be the first person to tell you that, because, you know, my experience is I think the last thing the board wants or the administration wants or the community wants is to invest in a process that doesn't really have a reasonable chance of success. When we do see feasibility, that second bullet kicks in gear, which is to understand how might you go about structuring this measure in a way that it's consistent with the type of measure that your community is interested in supporting. There's a lot of components to a bond proposal. There's the aggregate bond amount. How much is that going to be? There's the underlying tax rate. There's how you would propose to spend the money on your facilities if it were successful. What types of accountability provisions are built in, et cetera. These are all sort of questions that ultimately need to be answered before you were to place a measure on the ballot, and the survey can help guide that. And then finally, it's an opportunity also to understand the role of information and how it shapes voters' opinions about your proposal. You know, I'm a big believer that if a public agency is going to take the step of putting a measure on the ballot and asking voters to make this decision, it's really incumbent upon that agency to inform voters about the decision you're asking to make, right? As a public agency, you aren't advocating up or down, yes or no, on this proposal, but you are just in the role of giving voters information about what your facility needs are, how this bond might address. That way they have the information they need to feel well-informed and then make their own decision. In terms of the methodology or how we went about doing this study, it's a little different than the last time we worked with you. You know, the last time we were here, we were sort of on the tail end of what I call the golden age of the telephone interview, which was when everybody still had landlines and not that many people had caller ID. And when we rang you, usually in the middle of dinner, you had to actually go over and pick up the phone and answer it and say hello to figure out who was on the other end. A lot has changed, obviously, in terms of the technologies, and we've evolved our methodologies to keep pace. We are now, in terms of recruiting methods, we are using email, text, and telephone, right? All three. We find that that's the most effective way to get a balanced sample. All of the pins or the hyperlinks that are built into our email and our text invitations are unique to that respondent. So that protects the integrity of the site. Only those who are randomly selected to participate can do so. And it restricts them to one time only. They had the option of taking it in by telephone or online, whichever was the preference, as well as in English or in Spanish. And we had set out originally to do 600 completed interviews. And we walked back in the door with 866. So we had a really nice response from the community in terms of their willingness to take this study. And the beauty of that is it reduces the overall margin of error for this study to plus or minus 3.3% at the 95% confidence level. What that means is we can be 95% confident that the results I'll share with you tonight are within 3.3% of what we would have found had we spoken with all of your voters. I'm going to jump back to the top bullet now just to comment a little bit on how we structured our sample. Anytime we're doing revenue measure feasibility studies, the first question we want to sort of answer is what election cycle is this measure likely to be on? Because depending on what election you're on, you can have different voter turnouts, and the sort of the profile of that electorate can change. And so in this case, we were looking at that November 2024 presidential general election. It's going to have a very high turnout. And so we identified every voter in the district who was, we expect, based on when they registered to vote, what elections they've taken advantage of since that point, and some other demographics, are what we call likely November voters. We think they're going to show up and cast ballots this coming November. We then use a process called stratified and clustered random sampling, which I can get into the details if you like, but suffice to say that it guarantees us at the end of this process that we have a sample that matches your likely voter universe on all the dimensions that we know tend to drive how voters vote on bond and tax measures. So things like age, gender, partisanship, household party type, that's actually the single best predictor. Knowing somebody's a Democrat, for example, tells me a little something about how they may vote on a tax measure. Knowing that they live with another Democrat actually tells me more, because it's that household dynamic that tends to shape how people behave in the ballot box. And so we pay very close attention to the distribution of that electorate in your district, and then we make sure our sample matches that. And you can see that on this next slide here. This is just a quick overview. That middle column is the percentage breakdown within the likely November universe within the district by age, partisanship, household party type, whether they're a homeowner or not, as well as in what trustee area they reside. And to the right is the universe of our sample. And you can see how closely those percentages line up, right? We're either dead on or within a point or two in all cases. One thing that isn't shown here is language. 4% of the interviews that we completed were within Spanish. And when you look at the likely voter file, what you see is 1% have requested Spanish ballots in language ballot materials, but 4% were identified as probable Spanish speakers. So we line up really well with that as well. Okay, so on to the results. This first slide shows the results of what we call our importance of issues question. And for each of the issues you see there on the slide, we simply ask voters to tell us how important is this to them. Is it extremely important, very important, somewhat important, or not at all important? Asked in a random order, but sorted here from high to low based on that combined percentage of folks who said it's either extremely or very important. We like to ask this question up front because it's a great warm-up question, kind of just gets voters into the groove of taking the survey, thinking about their local community, makes good on that promise that we made to them that this is going to be a survey about important issues. And here we are getting to that in the very first question. So it builds rapport, but is also kind of a useful way to see how education stacks up against some of these other issues that also compete for tax dollars. So things like improving public safety, right? Or protecting the environment. And in particular, how does maintaining the quality of education in local public schools stack up against the issue of preventing local tax increases? Rough rule of thumb makes a lot of sense. The bigger the gap with education being valued as more important than preventing local tax increases, the better position you tend to be moving forward with some type of bond measure. And you can see here that that gap's about 25%. That is a little larger than what we've been seeing in most districts over the last two election cycles. Most time that gap's about 23% or so, 22%. So that's a good thing to have a slightly larger gap. The other thing I will point out though, is you look kind of down the list in the middle of the pack there, you see repairing and renovating aging school facilities. That checks in at 72%. Extremely very important, which is above preventing local tax increases, but well below this issue of maintaining the quality of education in local public schools. I point that out not because that's an unusual pattern. We see that pattern all the time, but it's a healthy reminder that, you know, at the end of the day, voters don't care so much about facilities when it comes to education as they care what happens inside those facilities. And so it's always really important to be connecting the dots between what it is you're constructing or fixing or repairing with your bond, but ultimately why it matters to your core mission of educating students. So after that warm-up question, we get right down to business with what we call the initial ballot test. And the idea here is before we get any deeper into the interview, and we start talking about possible tax rates that could be associated with this proposal, the types of projects that could be funded, and presenting arguments pro and con related to this proposal, we want to present to respondents a mock-up of what we think that 75-word ballot statement could look like and get their reaction. The initial ballot test is a really good gauge of where your community is at on the natural with respect to this proposal. The one thing I will point out here is we're testing on the larger side. We have an $845 million bond with a tax rate of $52 per 100,000 assessed valuation. For a Prop 39 bond, the max is 60. So we're not at the max, but we're testing kind of a higher tax rate. And so that is the language that we tested. And here are the results. So at that initial ballot test, we had 55% of respondents say that they would support this proposal. You had 31% who were opposed, and the rest being unsure, preferring not to answer the question. So in the state of California, for a Prop 39 bond to be successful, you need 55%. So we are sitting right there on the bubble at 55% at that initial ballot test. So naturally, support for a measure like this can depend on the price tag, right? The more expensive you make a measure, all other things being equal, the less support you can expect. And one of the things we want to do in the survey is make it really clear that bonds mean taxes, right? We're not hiding the ball. And we wanted to understand kind of how tax rate sensitive your voters are with respect to this proposal. And we do that in a couple of ways. This first slide shows the results of what we call our tax threshold question, where we say, if you heard that the annual property taxes on your home would increase by, at the top of the list, $52 per 100,000 of assessed valuation. Would you vote yes or no? If they are anything but a definitely yes, you go to the next lower number, which is 47 per 100,000, then 36 and 24. This going from high to low is called a Dutch auction. It is proven to be the best way of figuring out where, you know, sort of at each level a respondent's willing to jump in or not. And what you see here is, you know, some considerable tax rate sensitivity, right? At the top number, $52 per 100,000 of assessed valuation, we had 41%. We don't get a lot of movement when we move to $47. We get a jump at 36, and then you get a big jump at 24. And so that tells you that, you know, some of your voters are tax rate sensitive when it comes to this proposal. The other thing I will point out about this question in particular is we know it is a conservative read on support for your proposal for a couple of reasons. One is the nature of the question is we're sort of putting blinders on somebody and we're saying, I'm going to focus your attention on the tax rate. I'm going to focus your attention on the price tag, irrespective of kind of how this money is going to be used and the types of facility improvements that you get. So a bond proposal is a package. We're sort of reaching in, pulling the price tag out, setting it aside and focusing their attention on that. When you do that, you always get some fall off in terms of support. The other reason, though, it's a conservative read is when we say, if you knew that the property taxes on your home would increase $52 per 100,000 of assessed valuation, not everybody knows what that means, right? You have to know what assessed valuation is. You have to have some reasonable estimate of what the AV is for your property. You've got to do math pretty quickly in the space of an interview, right? And understandably, not everybody's good at that. And so what happens is there's a certain percentage of voters who they understand you're talking about price. They don't know what it adds up to. And so they'll hedge. They'll say, no, we're not sure. So that's why we also come about it a little differently. We say, this is the left column. All right, let me put it another way. If you knew that this measure would cost the typical homeowner about $184 per year, would you vote yes or no on the bond measure? The $184 per year is the $52 per 100,000 assessed valuation tax rate multiplied times the median assessed value for a residential property in your district. So it's what that typical median homeowner would pay. So those two numbers are comparable. And what you see is that when you go ahead and do the math, you get a more positive response to that tax rate. When we tested the $52 per 100,000 assessed valuation tax rate on the prior slide, we had 41% support. When you do the math and say that's $184 per year, it jumps to 50%, right? So we go up about 9 points. Same exercise on the right, only this is based on that $36 per 100,000 assessed valuation tax rate, for which we found 49% support on the prior slide. When you do the math and it adds up to $127 per year for the typical homeowner, we're actually checking in around 53%. All of this information is just really useful for answering what's probably the toughest question most districts have to answer when it comes to putting their bonds on the ballot, which is, where do we set the tax rate, right? Obviously, the higher you set it, the more revenue you have to address your facility needs, but also the higher you set it, the more risk you take on that, okay, we may not hit the 55. As you raise the price, you tend to lose some support. Okay, so after that long discussion about tax rates, we move on to what we call the projects and improvements section of the survey. And here we're really trying to do two things. One is we're now going to start to educate this respondent more about what this measure would accomplish by unpacking this bond proposal into a series of discrete uses of the funds to understand how they feel about each of the ways that you could spend bond proceeds. And so by doing that, they're learning more about the proposal. It also allows us to understand, you know, of all these ways you can spend the money, how do they feel about those? And is there anything on your list that's what I call an anchor? Meaning voters really don't see the merit of the project. They're not enthused about raising their taxes to support it. And if you put it in your project list, it tends to weigh it down like an anchor on election day. As you can see here on the slide, and I've broken into two tiers just because it's easier to see when you break it into two tiers. Tier one, there are no anchors on this slide, right? Every single project tested on tier one had at least 80% of respondents say that they would favor spending some of the proceeds on that issue. And by the way, the top two items there, they look like it's a repeat. What we're doing is we're testing a subtle wording change between the number one and number two. They're basically the same project, but we use a different adjective. And you can see that they still test similarly. So that was in a split sample study. So everything on the list here is popular. When you look at the things that are at the top of the list, they're typical of what we see in most school bond surveys that we're doing. It's a combination of bringing your older schools and facilities up to new school standards, career technology, STEM. And, you know, when you get into some of these older properties that may have, you know, asbestos in the roof or tiles or something like that, voters like to see that taken care of as well. Second tier here, lots of other popular projects. The very bottom one here, I'll just point out, I have yet to figure out how to crack the riddle in speaking about TK in a way that people can wrap their heads around, right? For whatever reason, you see it here and you see it in all the other districts, whenever you talk about TK specific improvements, I just don't think people kind of get it, or they don't, you know, they don't certainly don't rate it as high as they do some of the other things. So, okay. So if you as a board were to choose to place a measure on the November ballot, there's going to be an election cycle. And during that election cycle, there's going to be a lot of discussion and debate in the community about this proposal. You'll have advocates of this measure will go out and talk to their neighbors and friends and explain why this is needed and why they should vote yes. You might have some opponents who step up and say, this is a horrible idea. We shouldn't be doing this. And here's why. For this survey to be a reliable gauge of the feasibility of a bond measure, we need to know not only where your voters today, which was that initial ballot test, but also how do they react to the type of discussion and debate that they're going to encounter during the election cycle and how that may shape their opinions about your proposal. So we do that by testing both positive and negative arguments in the space of the survey. Shown here are the positive arguments we tested. You can see a lot of these arguments are resonating. They're getting traction with your voters. The top one here is interesting. You know, in the past, when we've talked about issues like portable replacement, it's kind of a lukewarm project, right? And sometimes voters, you know, feel like almost like it's a little wasteful, right? Wait a minute, we have a classroom where now we're going to replace it with another classroom. But when you can sort of describe the problems that you have with some of these older portables, right, and how many you have, it suddenly leapfrogs to the number one positive argument, right? And so, again, a lot of positive arguments that get traction. So at this point in the survey, voters have now heard more about this proposal than they did initially. After the initial ballot test, we had that long discussion about tax rates. That was a big wet blanket on support for the proposal. But we had a chance to come back, talk in more detail about the projects, share positive arguments. And so we go to what we call the interim ballot test, where we present that same 75-word ballot statement. And we say, now that you've heard a bit more, where do you stand? And what you see here is that we tick down about a point from where we were at the initial ballot test. We're at 54% support at the interim ballot test, 36% opposed, and the rest unsure. This is everything to do with the fact that the ballot language, that 75-word ballot statement that we're testing, is testing a higher tax rate, right? So we had this, you saw in that tax rate discussion where we were at $52, it was, you know, that it dropped support. Each time we're hitting these ballot tests, we're testing the 75 words with a $52 per 100,000 assessed valuation tax rate. So that's why this number, instead of kind of going up, stays real steady. And then we get to the negatives. And so the idea behind the negatives is I'm going to pressure test respondent support for this proposal by peppering them with some of the negative arguments that they could encounter during an election cycle. You'll notice that we test fewer negatives than positives. That's by design. What we tend to find in most school bond elections is the advocacy group tend to be much larger in number. They're organized, they raise money, they just have a louder voice than do the opponents. And so we simulate that disparity by testing fewer negatives. But the negatives we're testing are designed to be hard-hitting negative arguments. They're phrased in a way that we would expect an opponent to phrase them. And you can see that some of these negatives also get some traction, right? And so the real question, though, is what happens afterwards? And that is here. So after the negatives, we drop about 6 points from where we were at the interim ballot test. We have 48% support, 41% opposed, and you still have about, what is that, rounds to 11% of voters who are unsure or prefer not to answer the question. So before I get to my conclusion side, I want to share some sort of background data. This is a historical comparison between where we are today, which is the 2024 with the polling, And shown on the left is the 2016 polling we did, as well as the election result. As we just walked through here, back in 2016, we did an initial ballot test, an interim ballot test, and a final ballot test. And you can see that back then, we had support ranging between a high of 68% and a low of 62%. On election day, you got 65. So it was right in the middle of that range that we had tested in the polling. 2024, you can see it's kind of a similar step down pattern, right? The initial is the highest, the interim is kind of the middle one, the final is lowest. So the trajectory of the support in the space of the poll was similar, but we're starting about 13 points lower than we were in 2016. So the question is why? Like, why is that? Is that something happening here in Elk Grove? Or is this reflecting of some sort of larger patterns that and forces that we're seeing around the state? And it is definitely more the latter. Some of the things that we're seeing here in terms of just starting out lower today than we were in 2016, we're seeing that in a lot of the districts that we've worked with back in prior to 2018 on their bonds, that today we're seeing that the support levels are just a little lower than they were starting out and ending. And the reason for that isn't so much unique to what's going on in the district, but there's sort of three larger forces at play. The first one's a big one, which is in 2018, so after you passed your last bond, there was legislation called AB 195 that passed, and it required that we phrase the 75-word ballot statement differently than we did before. It now includes, in addition to the aggregate bond amount, you have that tax rate that we know is confusing to some voters. It has the annual levy. It talks about the duration. It's this mouthful of somewhat confusing items. And we did a ton of research then, and we continue to see that basically those, just that change in how you phrase the 75-word ballot statement results on average in a 7% reduction in support for school bonds. And so of that 13% that we just saw, that the gap between where you were in 16 and where you are now, about 7% of that is AB 195 right away. Beyond that, we have a couple other things going on now that are a little different. One is, you know, we just went through this period of, you know, where inflation hit, you know, 40-year highs. People are sensitive to that. People are sort of sensitive to cost of living. And it's made them a bit more tax sensitive and tax rate sensitive. And we're seeing this again around the state. And a lot of times for districts are finding that, you know, the $50 and $60 per $100,000 assessed valuation tax rates just really aren't feasible, and that they're moving forward with bonds that are smaller than what we tested here in terms of the tax rate. And then finally, one of the other things that's really changed is just how partisan everything has become. You may not remember back to 2016, but it wasn't like this, right? And over the last 8 years, we've now seen just the level of partisanship has grown, and what we've seen in it has started to shape how people see local measures. It used to be when I'd get this question from folks about, well, how much does what's going on nationally impact, you know, how voters view our local measure? And the answer was always zero, none, right? It just did not matter. You just, whatever was going on at the federal level, national elections, people were looking at these local measures as local measures. Now we've become so partisan that people are starting to look at everything through partisan eyes. And that has made, that's part of the, also the drop that you see in, in the support levels for school bonds kind of across the state. Okay. So I've got one more slide here. And I think Kristen, you've got the one behind me. So what does all this mean? I'm going to circle back first to that overarching question I mentioned at the outset is, that's the main motivator for why we do this research, which is to understand if it's feasible. Meaning, as if you as a board were to choose to place this measure on the November ballot, does it have a reasonable chance of success? The answer to that is what I call a qualified yes. It's a yes, but, right? It's a yes, but it's going to require adjustments when compared to what we tested here. And it's going to require very sort of robust engagement and communication to be viable. So why the yes part of that? That's what you see under the positive signs. A lot of the things that we want to see in place for a bond to be feasible, we see here. We saw that they, you know, your voters rated maintaining the quality of education in local schools among to be actually the most important issue facing the community. And we saw that it had that 25-point gap in importance relative to preventing local tax increases. That's something that is normally consistent with successful measures. We did see that support initially when they just read the 75 words, hit that 55% threshold. We also saw that the projects and improvements that you're looking at funding with this bond were all popular, and we have positive arguments that resonate. So those are some of the main pieces that we want to see in place for a measure to be feasible. However, we also see some challenges in this polling as well. The most obvious one being the tax rate sensitivity, right? We came out and tested a high tax rate, and we're seeing that that's sort of out of the comfort zone for some of your voters. So that's one of the challenges. It's going to be important to pick a rate that you can feel comfortable that 55% at least of your voters see that as within their range. We also saw that the opposition arguments resonate, right? At that final ballot test dropped about 7 points from where we were at the initial, and that has a lot to do with some of those opposition arguments. And then finally, stepping out of the polling and thinking just a little bit about what November 2024 is going to look like as an election cycle, we know it's going to be a hyper-partisan election. We can expect more of it as we get closer to Election Day. And there are also some other statewide initiatives out there that, although they don't deal with school bonds, are nevertheless going to sort of create their own weather system in terms of a high-level debate statewide about, you know, taxes and should we make them easier, should we make them harder to pass. Finally, there's the unknowns, right? Here we are, what, 10 months, 12 months? I mean, sorry, not 12 months, eight to 10 months ahead of Election Day. And if the last sort of 4 years have taught me anything, it's sort of to expect the unexpected, right? So right now, things seem to be heading our way. The economy has certainly been on a better path over the last year. Inflation has come down. It's not quite where we want it, but it's been much more stable and lower. But we don't know sort of what's going to happen exactly over the next, 8 to 10 months. And so we always want to, I like to think of when you put a measure on the ballot like this, you want to put a measure that can withstand some of these sort of headwinds, right? You don't want to put a measure up there that requires everything go your way, that it's blue skies and tailwinds all the way to Election Day. That's probably not realistic, right? It's probably going to be a little more turbulent than that. And we want to make sure we've got a measure that kind of can survive in that kind of environment. And so with that, I'm going to hand over the last slide.
Too far away.
All right, I'll be right.
All right. So we, of course, this is why we bring in the experts. There's a lot to unpack here and a lot to think about. And we certainly have spent a significant amount of time going through the high level results. But there's a lot more work to do. If you can think back to Tim's slide on the universe and really understanding who is supporting, why are they supporting? We really want to dig into the data to better understand who needs more information and would a public information effort help kind of close this gap or close the 11% that we're unsure or maybe undecided or not willing to respond. So with that, staff has some recommendations. It is this deep dive, taking time with this survey. It is a point of time. So the survey ran from January 8th through January 15th. And so that is, lots has changed just even since then, coming off the holidays and, you know, so that is something to take into consideration is where were people's mindsets at the beginning of January versus where might they be in a couple weeks or in a couple months, could be very different. We've already been working and partnering with the communications department to really showcase the successful efforts of Measure M and also thinking through and strategizing what would our communication be with some of the kind of key projects and areas of interest that show up in a poll like that, and really focusing on those types of project priorities in conversations with Tim and Lori and the entire team. We all kind of agree that having an additional survey come a bit later into the late spring, early summer to get a better understanding. When we do that, we'll know what happens in the March, early March primary in that election to see how there are some measures across the state for school bonds and how those might fare would give us a lot of more information. And so with all of Tim's information, with our conferring with the entire bond team, want to dig into the data, think through our communications and start getting some of that information out there to see would just the communication strategy help move some of the support and do that next tracking survey late spring, early summer to really put a recommendation forward. I'd say we're still relatively early on in this process. And I think with that, we've got the team here. Anything to add or any questions we take?
Thanks for the presentation. I don't have any particular questions right now.
Go ahead.
Okay. I just had a decision deadline. What is it?
Early August.
Early August. Thank you. It was presented very well.
So in if we're going to do a follow-up survey, would that test the same numbers or would we try to, would there be any tweaking to the numbers?
Typically the tracking surveys, we are going to want to test the proposal that the district is thinking about actually putting on the ballot. These baselines tend to be a little more exploratory, right? We're trying to figure out where that sensitivity is and kind of what the priorities are. The trackers, we zero in on a much more specific package that I think the tax rate's going to be aligned with what we think is a reasonable ask of the community at that point, based on what we learned before and, you know, some of the other, how the communications are going. So my expectation is we're not going to be starting at 52. We're going to be starting at something that's more modest, that is more in line with where, you know, we think voters are going to be supportive.
So this is more a question to Kristen and maybe the team. In terms of how are we balancing the need that we have, which I think without having gotten that information is going to be considerable, with our ability to get something that people will approve. And if we end up in a situation where I think last time around we asked for about half of what we needed, about half of what we needed is going to be considerably more than last time, or half what we need this time is probably going to be considerably more than last time. So what do we do, or how do we sort of balance that thought process?
It's a great question. We're always going to have more need than anything that's feasible, really, no matter how much the amount. So I think that's really important to keep in mind. I think the original facility master plan was well over $1 billion worth of need, and we brought in about $436 million to address that. Now, the district has an excellent track record of maximizing funds with Proposition 39, developer fees, et cetera, to make those dollars go even further. And so we would continue down that path to make sure we're stretching the dollars and doing as many of the projects. I think of the saying, like, how do you eat an elephant? It's like one bite at a time. And we're not going to have a measure, even if it were the max at $60, that would take care of all of the need, both for modernizing and upgrading our older schools and creating the new schools that we'll eventually need into the future. And so we just have to keep doing the work to keep it moving forward. And so and then just being smart with trying to find state matching funds, if there's grant opportunities, to braid those dollars to make them go as far as we can.
Is there a sort of kind of going along in that lines, is there a floor number where like anything below that and we're just nowhere near where we need to be? We're just not going to make the progress that we need to make?
Yeah. Yes. I don't know that number. I think that is in, you know, definitely conversations with the entire bond team and then direction from here, but it's a lot of staff time. It's a lot of expert consultant time and fees. And then on the other side, we need to leverage nothing that we can do here, but there is the advocacy campaign that doesn't happen at all with us. And those can be those can be expensive and time consuming as well. So I think balancing the time and the effort of what you can actually come back will be a consideration.
Okay, thank you.
I don't have any questions. Thank you for the presentation.
Can I add a couple of questions? No. I was thinking when Michael was speaking, you know, the survey indicate we have what, 866 survey, folks surveyed.
Yes,
and
correct.
I'm just curious, in terms of geography, mm-hmm. I was wondering, is that something that we could collect data and show on the map?
So we can, we have the ability, like I showed you the breakdown, we know the distributions by, you know, geography, trustee area, et cetera. That is information that can be made available. The concern is 866 is a lot of interviews. That's great. The moment you break it, you know, subdivide it seven times, now you can create, you know, now the margin of error in any one of those areas is going to be much higher, right? So overall, it's 3.3%. But the moment you look at a subgeography, like a trustee area, it's going to go to like plus or minus 10%+, right? Because we're now, instead of 866, you're dealing with one seventh of that.
Okay. Yeah, because I remember that the top category was quality of education, mm-hmm. which as a school district, that should be priority on top of everything. But I also saw the renovations as in the middle of the pack. But I think that could be better deep diving in if we could see what district it's coming from as far as the vote, I mean, that's their survey, and that would be more precise as far as that goes.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, the other piece is, and it's a challenge, it's not just, again, unique to Elk Grove, it's unique to any districts that's considering moving forward with this, is it's the communication exercise of sometimes helping them understand that your number one priority of education does have a connection to your facilities, right? That are making facility improvements is not just for taking care of the buildings. It's about actually being able to achieve that number one priority you have even better, which is, you know, educating students. So
yeah,
and communication.
Yeah. Because I mean, the reason why I focus on that, distinction of top priority is education to renovation, because for example, like area 1 and 3, there's a lot of transfer out versus transfer in, and part of it is the Title I, and you know, the program is great and all, but that transparency or the look of the school has something to do with it as well. And I just wanted to note that if we could put the survey into the map, see where it's coming from, I think we could do more deep dive on it. So think about that if you could implement it in the future. Thank you.
Really quick follow-up that just jumped into my mind. So you talked a little bit, Kristen, about the communication strategy of, you know, of the district. And so I guess, so help me understand how, what the line would be between the district's communication strategy and ultimately some future advocacy group, strategy, and how those two things, what's the wall between those two things?
Well, they don't mesh at all. I think that's like
why I said wall.
Important thing to say. We can share information. So we can share information about the projects that we've accomplished. We can talk about projects that are upcoming. Anything that's fact-based, we can talk about very publicly, and we have. Lisa and her team have done a great job kind of sharing that out through different social media. When it comes to actual kind of the details of what a GO bond would be, it would be tax rate. We could talk about what assessment evaluation actually meant. We can't advocate one way or another. for that. That would happen in with a completely different entity, nothing to do with Elk Grove, any materials or anything like that. So there is a very strict line. We'll get some communication out. Government Financial Services has had it on the queue, knowing that this conversation was going to come up. So we're happy to share that out on what the actual, where that line, that wall is, but that it is very distinct.
Yeah. And so I think, you know, I think that kind of what I'm, you know, getting at here is like the district can talk about the need, because obviously there's going to be a significant amount of need here, right? We kind of know that going into this. And so the district is going to be making that argument, or is going to be providing that information.
On March 19th, we'll present the master plan, which will showcase the need throughout the district.
Okay. I think that makes sense. Thank you.
Yeah. So once there's kind of that distinguishing line in my brain that kind of helps is once the board bangs the gavel and says, we're making the decision that we're going to put an item on X ballot, that's where you have to be absolutely crystal clear that this is the only information. And at that point, there will be an outside entity in the best case scenario that will take to the advocacy piece. And there'll be people from the district that are part of it, but it's outside of their day. We have to be very clear about making the distinctions on when we're doing public work and when we're representing the district. So there's been a lot of work that goes into that. But once the board bangs the gavel and says, we've made the decision to put it on the ballot, that's when we're just crystal clear about the distinction.
All right. Well, thank you so much for the presentation. I think my colleagues asked all of the questions I had as well. So thank you so much. Yeah. I apologize. Ms. Levasseur, did we have any public comments via Zoom for that item?
Okay. So I'm going to die. Madam President, no, there are no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Okay, and there were no blue cards, Mr. Vargas?
Correct, there are no blue cards on this item.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Riley, going to present on the tentative agreement between Elk Grove Unified School District and Elk Grove Education Association regarding comparability study.
No, there we go. Okay. Good evening, President Jamerson, members of the board, Superintendent Hoffman, Ms. Levasseur. The tentative agreement between the Elk Grove Unified School District and the Elk Grove Education Association regarding the implementation of the comparability study has been ratified by a vote of the EGEA members. Education Code Section 3540.2 stipulates a fiscal review by the Sacramento County Office of Education of negotiated agreements to determine the financial impact of the agreement on the district budget. The AB 1200 report, which provides the financial analysis of the tentative agreement, is attached and was submitted to SCOE for their review and subsequently approved. As such, the EGUSD board is asked to approve or ratify the attached tentative agreement.
I would like to open the public hearing and call on Lisa Levasseur if there are any public comments via Zoom related to this item.
Madam President, there are no public comments via Zoom for this item.
Mr. Vargas, are there any blue cards related to this item?
We have no blue cards on this item.
I would now like to close the public hearing and call for a motion to approve the tentative agreement between Elk Grove Unified School District and Elk Grove Education Association regarding the comparability study.
So moved. Second.
It was moved by Mr. Yang and seconded by Mr. Vargas. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
All right. Do we have board members, or would our superintendent wish to report on any organization or committee meetings relative to the district and its operation? Yes, Ms. Albiani.
I went to the SCOE meeting, and it was on artificial intelligence, which is very interesting. And I've had a discussion with Mr. Hoffman, and we are in the process as a district also understanding that. And I think the world, so we are aware. I also was able to attend the district staff meeting, which we had here, and they did some information and shared about our diversity, equity, and inclusion work. And I just wanted to share a few of those numbers. We've had over 7,000 people, and this was probably 3 weeks ago, participate in DEI training. We've had 53% finish it. There are 228 classes they can take. We have 108 trainers. We have almost 3,500 employees that have received at least one payment for completing a portion of it. And the percentage of staff who are included with academic student contact is 67%. And the hours completed are 95,724. So it's just very impressive how it's happening. It's been a goal for a long time for this board. And so it's very exciting to see it happening. And I thought this was a great way to share it out. Thank you.
Thank you for that information. That's good news. Mr. Hoffman? No. Okay. Well, then I would like to adjourn this meeting at 7:41 p.m. Have a great evening. Stay dry.